Dobro večer želim svima. Drago mi je što smo se svi mogli ponovo okupiti na ovo lijepo mjesto da slavimo našeg dragog Gospoda zajedno. So good afternoon everyone. I'm very happy to see everyone here gathered together in this beautiful place to praise our God together. Pre nego što počnemo naš popodnevni čas, otpjevamo ćemo pjesmu broj 363 i posle otpjevane pjesme zamolila bi crkvu da ostane stojeći dok pročitam jedan psalam za završetak subote. I nakon pročitanog psalma pomolit ćemo se posle toga. So, before we start our afternoon service, I'd call the church to sing song number 363. And I'll ask the church to stay standing as we close the Sabbath day with a psalm and a prayer. So we're going to sing song number 363. So for those that want to follow in English, I'm going to read a few verses from the 27th psalm. I kaže, Gospod je vidjelo moje i spasenje moje, koga da se bojim. Gospod je krepost života mojega, koga da se strašim. Ako navale name zlikovci da pojedu tijelo moje, protivnici i neprijatelji moji spotači će se i pašće. Ako protiv mene vojska u oko stane, neće se uplašiti srce moje. Ako se name rat digne, ja se ni onda neću bojati. Zajedno samo molim Gospod, samo to ištem, da živim u domu Gospodovu sve dane života svojega, da gledam krasotu Gospodovu i ranim u crkvu njegovu. So I'm just going to ask the church now to bow their heads for prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for your Sabbath and the special sanctuary and time you've given us that we can spend with you and we can learn more about you and just show love to one another and just see how much you love us. I pray that you're with everyone today who's participating, that they can be filled with your Holy Spirit and accept him into all of our hearts, and that we can always do things to your glory. And may we always be searching for the kingdom, and may that always be on our mind and focus. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Večeras ćemo imati priliku da čujemo iskustva naših mladih koji su išli na konferenciju GYC ili Generation of Youth for Christ, koja je bila u Louisville, Kentucky. So this afternoon service, we're going to hear a little bit about some experiences from some of the youth that went to GYC, which was in Louisville, Kentucky, which is a conference for youth ages 18 to 35. Krenuli smo s autobusom iz Londona, a iz naše crkve bilo nas je 15. So we went on a bus with a bunch of other churches, and there was actually 15 youth from our church that went. Naslov teme za GYC je bilo called, chosen, faithful, ili pozvan, izabran, vjeran. So the title for the conference was, as we see on the screen, called, chosen, faithful. Dani su nam bili dosta naporni, pošto smo imali puno aktivnosti. Svaki dan smo nešto malo drugačije radili. Prvi dan smo imali 4 radionice, sljedeći dan smo išli na outreach cijeli dan, od vrata do vrata, i svako jutro i svako veče imali smo 2 glavna govornika. Ujutro je bio Taj Pakleb, a popodne je bio Sebastian Braxton. I bilo je jako, vrlo zanimljivo. So it was a really busy conference for us. We had really jam-packed days, and every day we did something different. So the first day we actually had 4 seminars, and then the second day we had a full day of outreach. But each day we also had morning worship and afternoon worship. So morning we had Taj Pakleb, who's from Hawaii, and then Sebastian Braxton in the afternoon. And it was very interesting. So, ja sam htjela malo da na našem počnem uvod, pošto će najvećina pričati na engleskom, ali bit će simultani prevod ako neko treba. Sonja je rekla da može, ali ne znam ako neko treba možda. Nek samo se javite meni posle. So, I was just saying that if anyone needs translation into our language, there's going to be simultaneous translation, and you can come to me afterwards if you need it. Ali sada bi pozvala Sašu da podijeli malo slika i iskustva sa GYC. So now I'm going to call Sasha to share a few photos and a little some experiences as well from GYC.
So, like Nikki said, the conference was called Chosen Faithful. So everything we went to had this idea kind of woven into it. And by the end, I hope that's what I've gotten across. So actually, can we have the lights turned, like the spotlights off or whatever has to be turned off so we can see a bit more? So I want you to look at the facial expressions on people going. These lights here. Look at this one. They're passed out. Distracted. So the night before GYC, we basically, the way we went, the 15 of us, we had had to drive to London to be there by 6 a.m. to get on a bus to drive 9 more hours to get to the conference. So to get to London, we had to wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning. Yeah. Leave by 3:34 to be there by before 6 to get on the bus, because you know you want to save your seats and make sure you have a good spot for the whole ride. So some people decided, why go to sleep and wake up at 3? Why not sleep at all? So most of them didn't sleep. I think I got an hour and a half. The drivers that drove to London drove more than 3 hours, slept more than 3 hours the night before. But basically on the way there, we were extremely tired. Most of us slept the majority of the way. And it was so interesting looking at these pictures after the fact, seeing what we looked like before we went. And then I'll show you a picture on the way back and tell you what the bus ride like was on the way back. Oh yeah, there, really passed out. I think, wait, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. These aren't even us, that's just other people. Like the whole bus was passed out. Okay, so we got to the conference. at, I believe we got there a little bit late. We got there around 4:30. The first session that night had already started, so we rushed to go check into the hotel, throw our bags in our hotel rooms, get dressed, you know, make sure we kind of clean ourselves up a bit and run to the first plenary session. So like, actually, the session wasn't this guy. He was the main speaker. Well, that's amazing. I still need to look here, unfortunately. But so the first session was the president of the GYC, who's a really, really inspiring young woman. We got to see a bit of her, and you could still tell we were all just tired and excited to be there, but really tired. It was a little bit hard to focus. And this evening plenary at 4:30 was kind of the schedule of every night to come. There was always going to be a session between 4:30 and 6 that we were always going to be at. The following four nights were going to be Sebastian Braxton. He was fantastic. So actually, one thing, or I'll share that with you later. So the first night and a couple nights afterwards, Nikki did a really, really great job at creating these debrief meetings. So we wouldn't just go to the final session and dinner and then go back to our rooms and watch movies and stuff. We'd actually come together with our notebooks. So we each brought a notebook like this that we took to all of our sessions, and we'd go back and see what we got out of it, because not only was there evening sessions, but I'm going to show you in a bit, there were seminars. There were so many that there wasn't possible to go to all of them. So we'd all go to our seminars, take notes, and come back and say what was our like favorite points or things that we had learned. And then we'd pray together. And this was, because it was still Wednesday. So we had this, and we would plan, open up our books, look at all the options, and plan where to go to the next day. So breakfast was nice and early at 6:30 a.m. So waking up early after not sleeping the night before, I think Nikki slept 4 hours in 2 days. It was really, really like hardcore. This is no pansy conference. This is a marathon, and it started really hard right off the get-go. But the cool thing was there was at least one of us at breakfast every day. I didn't miss breakfast. Did you? Anyone else not miss breakfast? I think we did pretty good, actually. It was pretty good. Anyway, so after breakfast, we had our morning plenary session, so there was a morning devotional, and then, which was led by Taj, was it Plukheb? Pakleb? Really, really amazing young man from Hawaii. And then we go into our seminar sessions. So there were 17 different session series that we could follow. Not like 17 different, you know, one after the other. Literally, there were 17 different speakers in different rooms talking about different topics every single time. So there were 6 seminars happening at each session time, and you'd have to pick which of the 17 you were going to go to for that session slot. So that's extremely difficult to do, because with 17 options, there's obviously going to be at least 2 or 3 that you find really interesting. And so we had to kind of, at least the first day, we split into maybe 3 groups, because everyone kind of wanted to stay together as friends. So we're all kind of, you know, still new to this. Those of us who have been there before would take, you know, we'd go off and take our groups to one of the seminars that was maybe more popular. This one was one that was on the history of Egypt. He's actually an anthropologist. It wasn't like you were talking to a pastor who also by chance studies the history of Egypt. He's actually an anthropologist and archaeologist. So he was somebody who had actual information from the field, dig sites, and went through the history of Egypt from before Moses, and then showed how we actually do see that part of history that's in the Bible in real life. And it was crazy. Nikki and I think we were like, our hands were cramped from writing notes afterwards. If you want to hear about it, let us know. And actually, I can tell you where you'll find audio recordings of all these seminars. After that, I'll give you actually a couple examples. So that was the Egypt one. Then there was one on Christian finances. So given that we're all young people, you know, stuff like giving tithe and how much offering, and do we put money aside, and what do you do with money, how much should you keep, how much should you be giving to others in charity. This gentleman and his wife actually have a blog, a Christian finance blog, and they talk about these things, how to save up so that you can give more, that kind of thing. So I didn't get a chance to go this one, but it was, I think, yeah. Johnny went to all 6 of them. There we go. So we had some people that decided, yeah, if you want to talk more about it later, we can definitely do it. Or you can talk to Johnny about it. So some people chose to go to a different speaker each seminar. Some chose to stick with one and go all the way through because they were so good. This one is there was a whole seminar on healing broken relationships. So stuff like how to forgive, how to deal with heartbreak, how to move forward, and then how we, you know, use biblical examples in Christ to use that in our own lives, which was really great. And we had a couple people that went to those as well. And then we also had good old apologetic seminars. This one was the final one of the six. They actually had a whole panel. So you had five really, really well-known apologists all on the panel being, like, we could ask them questions. So really, really cool things. And you have people, the people that come to these seminars are not, you know, what I consider, you could consider like lazy Christians. You have people who know their Bible and know it well. They know Spirit of Prophecy, so the questions that are asked are intense. It's very, very serious question and answer. And Nikki went to this one. She said it was really, really great. She also has notes on this one. And all of these seminars were auto, there was an audio recording, and so you can find them on Audioverse, and I can give you the website later on. It's just audioverse.org. GYC seminars are updated every year, so you can actually go back to the previous years as well. So the main speaker, Sebastian Braxton, he, I think, had probably the most profound impact on our youth kind of as a whole. Bonnie, Nikki, and I first heard him maybe six years ago, and he was great then, and he was just amazing. I'm going to share with you for this section what, there was two things that I think a lot of us found really interesting. One, that I personally, he said this, and we were trying to take like little notes that in and of itself could be something that we could share. He said, "We are made in the image of God." Sure, we all know that, but what I hadn't thought about before was we, therefore, if we don't know God, we don't know our own identity. So if you think about that, and there was a couple things that he had built on. It was a whole, for made in the image of God, that we're not made in a sinful image. We can't say we're sinful people like we are. Like, don't misunderstand what I'm trying to say. But the fact that we were initially made to be made in the image of God, that means we had this, we were made to copy this perfect, amazing thing. There's such beauty in that creation. And so there's beauty in who we are and who we can be and who we should be. And it was just something that I hadn't thought of before. Another thing he said was about, he talked a lot about habits and how that affected us. And actually, Mark Finley also talked about that, so I'm going to leave that quote till afterwards. But Sebastian Braxton really did an amazing job. And I think even though his sermons were an hour, at the end of the day, after long seminars, we all attended, which was really great. Then we had New Year's. So GYC always happens around New Year's. We're in Louisville, so you know, you don't really know what you're going to end up doing for New Year's. They normally have like a prayer and singing kind of event that night where you pray in the New Year. So we participated a little bit in that. And then we also, these kind of happen spontaneously at GYC normally. Spontaneous groups kind of come together and start singing. And like half the people there all know how to harmonize ridiculously, so it ends up being like these heavenly choirs in hallways that you just kind of run into, and as soon as someone hears someone singing, they just kind of join. So this group's kind of just grow in like stairwells, and this was in the convention center. So it was really cool. Then so this kind of just ended up happening. And on New Year's Eve, after, you know, you have people who had gone to parties and bars, we were in the core of Louisville, this circle actually moved outside these doors, which was part of the main drag to get into the core party area. So we'd had these, we're singing like Amazing Grace and Draw Me Close and all these really beautiful heartfelt songs in like five-part harmony. And then people who are coming back from New Year's parties are walking by and slowly like they would stop and listen. And there was a couple that joined. One middle-aged man joined and started crying. Like it was just, and that was our New Year's. Like how cool is that? And then we stayed there for like at least half an hour in the cold. It was freezing. It was amazing. We also made new friends. I don't know if you can see this. Oh yeah, this guy and his wife. A couple from, we'll say BC, he's from Idaho. Anyways, we found out, Bonnie met them at one of the booths she was helping out with, ends up he's part Serbian, he's like, my family! And he doesn't speak the language, but we ended up talking, and then they ended up being really, really cool, and they ended up basically being adopted by us. They were with us like for everything after that. It was really amazing. They felt so loved, and I think they might be visiting us soon. It was really a true adoption. So you see maybe we're here by the Louisville sign. Another thing that happens during GYC is outreach. This is something that normally makes people squirm a bit. If you haven't ever done it before, you're thinking knocking on doors, that's terrible. We're invading people's privacy and people don't want to hear us. I don't want to give people books. I didn't sign up for this. I came to get, you know, information myself. And that's what I thought the first year was really awkward. Pardon? Oh yeah, and we're doing it on New Year's Day. So not only are people in their homes, they're also probably hungover and tired and just, you know, it's an interesting mix of things kind of coming together. So for a lot of us, it was our first time doing this. And it was a huge group of us that ended up going, and which is amazing because it takes a lot of courage. Basically, we spend an hour in one of the plenary sessions. They basically tell you what your outreach goals are that day. So every year it changes. This year, we were going to go out, and because it's the new year, we were going to, you know, introduce ourselves, say, you know, it's a new year. That means it's a lot of people like to make kind of New Year's resolutions and make positive changes in their lives. So we're here at a Christian youth conference called GYC, and they're planning on putting a bunch of health seminars in the near future. We have a list of options. We wanted to just do a little survey to see what you would be interested in. And so it's just a survey. It was very tame, it made complete sense to be doing it on New Year's Day. So we had physical health seminars, we had mental health seminars, we had spiritual health seminars. There was also a revelation prophecy seminar and Bible studies that people could request. So we'd be offering kind of all these things depending on what the reaction was at the door. And then we'd also, if they wanted, we'd pray with them. So this is us getting, we'd get, there's like probably 30 or 40 of these school buses that pull up. And they would drop us off at different locations in the city. So you're put in groups of two or three. And then they give you a car that has a map of all the streets. And they say, this is where you're going to go. You have no idea where you're going to go. You could be going to the slums. You could be going to see mansions. Like, you have no idea. So we were dropped off. We all kind of made it so we were all on the same bus going to the same area. And this was one of the drop-off sites. So we stopped because half of us were really nervous. And we were cold because we did not think Louisville would be this cold. I thought it was further south. I don't know what happened. So we had a prayer to just kind of get us started. Pray for the houses that we were going to go to. So that if there were people who, you know, if we were going to be their opportunity to be exposed to God and the Bible in some way, that we have courage in that and that be kind of our driving force, that we know that God's with us. And I thought that was actually quite powerful. So we split up from there and went door to door. So Emily and I were partners. We were just the two of us. And I'll just share a quick experience from us. You can ask her what she experienced afterwards. We had a little area that was like on the verge of Sketchville. Like, it was started off houses and then turned into trailer homes? Well, yeah. It was a very interesting experience to see how a lot of people live. Because it was not dangerous from what we saw, it was just really sad, a lot of it. People really living very unhealthy lives, and all they needed was actually these health seminars, and a lot of them didn't want anything to do with it. They were like, oh no, I don't need that. But then there were some that it was what they were like waiting for someone to just show up. So there was one man who was like our second door. We opened it. He started talking. And all he could ask for, oh, my daughter needs this so much. She's going down a bad road. She needs prayer. She needs all these things. Sign me up for all of them. And basically what we would do, we'd get their email or phone number, and we'd tell them that somebody else would call them back for more information. So he just wanted to talk. Funny thing was, he ended up telling us that the area we were in was actually very dangerous, and that we, like, actually somewhere we saw Bonnie and a couple of their girls go, that he was like, are you going there? You probably should take a gun with you, just saying. And so nothing happened. It was really, like, it was a beautiful day, it was fine, but we know that our angels were with us. Even doing his work, it wasn't like we were in a third world country, but there was still, it's still not always completely safe, but we were taken care of anyways, so that was very nice. Another thing, there was an older woman who was suffering from depression, and her mother was in the hospital, and all she wanted to do was just talk. And she actually was on the phone when we got there, and she was like, can you guys come back? I'm on long distance. So we're like, okay. So we left, did a couple more houses, and came back. She was still on the phone. Please, please, come back, a couple more minutes. Or she didn't even, whatever. We ended up coming back a third time, and we thought, my goodness, what's this woman doing? She's wasting our time. I think we did three laps of our street going back to her house to coming back. Finally, when we got there, she let us in, and I think we talked for like 20 minutes. She wanted to know everything. She wanted to our support. She wanted, we prayed with her. She wanted the revelations. Actually, some people only wanted the Revelation series seminars. They didn't want to hear anything else, which was, I guess, the opposite of what I thought would happen. So that was really, really cool. So by the end of the day, all of us got back together. We share our experiences on the bus, and we're singing songs. And then we go back, and basically we hand in those maps where we've tallied how many people we've prayed with, who's requested Bible studies, how many surveys we've filled out. And the GYC committee, whoever counts them, and we find out what, you know, what impact did we have in Louisville after that. So, almost half of the conference attendees went out on outreach. So we had 1,755 youth going door-to-door and knocking in the city. 33,000 houses were knocked on, 5,000 prayers were held, and 1,300 people signed up for Bible studies in 3 hours. So the amount of time it would have taken a local colporter team to go around that city, it would have taken them 6 months to do the same amount of work. We did in 3 hours. That's pretty amazing. So every city GYC goes to, something like this happens. Same kind of effect. And whether or not people want to actually talk to someone at their doorstep, we're never invasive. It's always kind of like an information. We give them a glow track. And then if they want, we pray. And for some people, maybe this was their opportunity, you know, to see, to learn more about God. So that it's always really empowering, and it makes you feel less awkward going forward in the second time because you see the beauty in it. Okay, so Friday night was Friday was New Year's, so we got back from the outreach. We had a sermon, and we were like, "How, what are we gonna do for dinner?" So we ordered like 16 pizzas before. This was our Friday night Sabbath healthy dinner. We offered to people who would walk by us. It's like in the middle of the second floor of the lobby of our hotel. It was awesome, and this, you know, part of our debrief, opening up Sabbath. There was a lot of us. Are Julie and Jeff there? Yeah, look. See, they're still there. Okay. And then Sabbath morning, you know, getting ready. And Sabbath is a really big day. There's like there's a morning devotional, and then you have breakfast, and then you have another sermon, and then you have another, someone's really amazing testimony, and then lunch, and then two more seminars. So it's a true marathon, but it is truly, truly blessed. So for Sabbath, our sermon was Mark Finley, who's an oldie but a goodie kind of thing. He was, going into the whole GYC, I always kind of thought he would be a little bit, you know, I don't know, a little slow. He never, ever stops. This man, I've never gone to a bad sermon by him. He is just absolutely, every year after year, he keeps coming back to GYC. He believes in the conference, and he had an amazing sermon, and his thing was actually the one that was about action. So this is a quick takeaway. He said, "The mind is the measure of the man. What you often think about will lead to actions. Frequent actions lead to habits, and habits define your character." So then he went on to ask, what happens if you compromise integrity? And he was bringing in a whole bunch of different Bible characters, specifically Daniel, to talk about that. And that was something that, during our debriefs, that whole idea of something that starts with, what was it? Something you think about, even a thought, how that can lead to your character. There was at least 4 or 5 people, different people within the youth, who kept bringing that up, how that was a really big take-home message for them. And you can see here how big, this was actually one of the smaller conferences that we'd seen in a while. So it's a huge number of people. And on Sabbath day, it's no longer necessarily a conference. It's actually open to the whole community. So anyone in Louisville can come and listen to the Sabbath sermon and Sabbath school, which is really great. So it completely fills up. And at the end of his sermon, he had an altar call. And this is really powerful because you see it's like tons of people. It's not like pastors being, "Please, someone, anyone, come up. I know there's one of you in there." It's like hordes of people, all being so, so touched by the message. And there's a couple altar calls throughout the weekend that are really, really great. So there's also an exhibition hall. In the evenings and in the free time, a bunch of ministries, Adventist ministries, whether they're conference affiliate or schools or mission trip opportunities, all these things, they have booths that you can go and visit. And basically you can find out different opportunities for serving or going abroad or going, if you want to go to Adventist school, you can learn about it there. And we also made them fun. There was a beanbag that everyone ended up, I don't know, jumping on. I don't know how we adopted this kid. He was just there. And yeah, anyways. And this is where our girls made their meeting with Sebastian Braxton. They flagged him down, and that worked out really well. Everyone became friends. Yeah. The whole group again. We really were really good at staying together. Like, I'm noticing all the group shots. Nikki did a really amazing job keeping us as a group and together. But still, I'm going to give you some credit. Also, during our sermons, it was often calls for small group prayer, which was really great. So this scene, you'd see a lot. Whoever was speaking or who would have their testimony, they'd have a main message. And then at the end, they'd say, okay, so let's pray about this, this, and this, in groups of two or three beside each other. So then the whole room turns into this big prayer room, which is amazing. And like everyone's praying. It's not like, you know, two or three of the pious people. It's the whole room. It's so amazing. And the final charge was led by a wonderful young woman from Australia who, how much time do I have? I'm done. Okay. It's the last thought that really was strong for me. I hope a lot of other people. She came in to have her last sermon, and her basic thing was like, I'm gonna come in here, and when I leave, I want you to leave discontent. I don't want you to be happy. That was her whole like entrance, her introduction. And she finished it. Her whole thing was how can we be content with what we do as Christians? Like, we're not doing enough. Most of us aren't doing enough. So, and yet we're happy with the amount of work we do for God in our lives. So she brought these two one was an analogy, one was an example from a movie. The analogy was, there's nothing after that, is there? Oh, there we go. So the analogy was, there was a family with a little boy in their back seat in the car, and driving along the highway, and right in front of them, this massive car accident happens, and cars are flying, people are getting hurt, and somehow their car, that they veered enough to escape it and not get their car hit. So they're thinking, my gosh, thank you so much, God. We're safe. We're alive. But then they just kept driving on. And that night, the little boy had a really hard time going to sleep when his parents were, you know, saying, I know it's hard, but try to, you know, close your eyes. And he's like, Daddy, how can I sleep when people are dying? And so although we're not, like, it was this idea of people actually are dying without getting the message of God to them, but also this, just that there are people that are living this world and unsaved, like without knowing how much they're loved by God and how much that should make us want to get to them. And the last example was of Schindler's List. If you don't know Schindler, he was a man in the Second World War who basically successfully saved a whole lot of Jews over the course of the war. But at the end, he wasn't happy. And when he was asked, look, like you saved over 1,000 Jews. Like, how can you not be happy with all the good that you did? And he was saying, what do you mean? Look, I have this car. If I'd only sold this car, I could have saved 2 more people. What am I watch? Why do I have this watch? I didn't need this watch. That would be 1 more life. And he kept listing all these things that he had, that if he had just used to get money, he could have made some way for another life to be saved. And so he, at the end, is so, so unhappy. And no one else can understand it. And she used this as an example of how can we continue living our lives knowing, you know, with all the even things that we think are still kind of necessities, living the comfortable lives that we do when there are so many people that still haven't heard the gospel. And that she encouraged us to be discontent until every prayer, our prayer life is just, you know, on fire, that we're having experiences and that we're also, that we have the reason and courage to talk and share God with someone every day. And then she finished with a song that was a tearjerker. The lines were as if God is saying this. My house is full, but my field is empty. Who will go and work my field today? It seems my children all want to stay around my table, but no one wants to work in my field. We're all comfortable in the church on our Sabbath day rituals, but how often do we go out and try to share what we have here with others? So it's a very, very strong message. All in all, we have, at the end, this is the bus ride back. You'll see a very stark difference. We were sharing our testimonies. We were, you know, you'd have to go to the front of the massive bus. Joel and Bonnie, a couple other people shared what they experienced and, like, just beautiful, beautiful things. How they were changed or how they felt they were touched by God. And, you know, we were sharing our testimonies for hours, and then when we weren't sharing testimonies, we were singing. No one slept, I don't think. And it was just truly indicative of the blessed experience we all had. And I think you heard that in Emily's and Vanessa's testimonies today. Anyways, that was a long drawn out explanation. I hope you have a good idea of what we do at GYC and come with us next year.
Thank you, Sasha. If you guys can just put it back to the first slide. So the second part of our afternoon service, I'm going to call five different people to come up, and we're going to have a bit of a little interview so we can hear about people's experience. And then we'll also hear afterwards, David is going to have a 5-minute little explanation of his experiments, and that will kind of be the end of our service. So if everyone wants to, who's participating, come up and take a seat, please. I'm just going to start. Okay, perfect. So I'm going to ask everyone some questions. I'm just going to ask the question, and I just want to hear about three of you answer. If someone else has an answer, you can also answer. But just so we can kind of tell our family about our trip, and we heard only a few people tell their experiences, so I thought this was a good way that we could get a few more people to say their experiences. So my first question is going to be, tell me a little bit about what your favorite moment was at GYC. So whoever can speak up, go ahead.
All right, I guess I will. definitely one of the top moments, why I love going to GYC is because we're always together. And the top moment that that I like being together is when we debrief, those debriefing things that Sasha said earlier, where we all got around on the couches. And it was really relaxed, but it was also very serious. And the mixture of being relaxed, but also being very intent on being serious was, I think it's exactly the way youth should be always. We should be fun and enjoying of our faith, but then, you know, we have to be serious about it too. And that was awesome. It was really chill.
And by the end, we were kind of just... It was happening naturally, just like while we were eating.
And then we got on fire because of it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, very cool. Anybody else? Favorite moment?
My favorite moment is going to the sessions because there was an answer to prayer and a blessing. And the second one was actually getting to know each one of you guys because I'm not really involved here, but I want to start. So, yeah.
Amen. That was nice for us, too. It was really nice to spend the time together and really get to know each other in a special way.
Okay, go ahead, so Susie. My favorite moment was definitely the first evening devotional by Sebastian Braxton. It was called Come Back. And the first thing that he said that really touched me was beliefs lead to behaviors. And like he said that like you have to believe who you are. And it was really touching. And I really liked how he preached, and in the beginning when he started singing and everyone sang along, it was nice.
Yeah, every session Sebastian started, he would sing like, "Oh GYC, do you love Jesus?" And the whole GYC would respond. And just like every time he started, it was really nice.
My favorite moment, I would say, would have to be the New Year's Eve singing that we did in that hall area. It was just like, I think that was the best New Year's Eve I've ever had, because I'd always like, yeah, it was the best.
Not disagreeing, I'm agreeing, I'm just saying.
I just never had something like that, like just, I guess, spiritual. And it was just a really good thing that we had there. And all the other times I went to GOIC, the New Year's Eve thing would be me sitting in my hotel room with someone and just watching TV, and it'd be really boring. And we'd watch, like, New York's, like, the ball drop thing. And it was like, whatever.
Yeah, no, it was really special. We actually did it a few times. Sasha and I think we did in Baltimore 1 year. We started New Year's in prayer. Like, we went, there was this, okay, one thing we didn't go to, which I was really sad about, is there was this prayer room. It was so busy, like, you can't even go to everything. But
I can talk about that if you want me to.
You went to the prayer room?
No, we did. Really? I did walk into the prayer room, and I was thinking, like, New Year's, it should be a happy moment kind of thing. But when we walked into the room, now I'm not saying it's a bad thing to enter into a New Year with prayer. I think it's a really good thing. And I think it's something that everyone should do before going to New Year. But when we did walk in, it didn't seem like, I don't want to say it wasn't enjoyable, but it didn't seem like it was something that we could spend together and being happy. It seemed like a little too solemn. So it didn't seem like very like our scene. So we left and then started that singing group, which is what we enjoyed a lot. It was still praising God. It was just in a different way.
Yeah, so. But there's actually, though, a prayer room at GYC where it's open 24 hours, like, not 24 hours, but during the whole conference, that you could just go whenever. I would encourage us next time to try that out. But 1 year, Sasha and I in Baltimore, we had that experience where it was a little bit different because it was in groups and you were praying for each other, and it's a special moment, but that's going to just get us excited for next time.
Can I?
Yes, you can.
Okay. I think my favorite part, I mean, I liked all of GYC. Everything was great. I think we talked about everything. But my favorite part was, like Joel, those in-between times when we were by ourselves. And I just found that we were having those conversations, but we were talking about God, right? So you could choose to talk about anything you wanted, but we were talking and we were asking questions and really focusing on that. And I really felt the Spirit, which was really great.
Yeah, one little experience I want to share. I'm not going to mention any names, but someone in my room, all of a sudden I heard them singing, like, humming Marching to Zion. And I was like, okay, like, you know you're listening to a lot of Christian music when you hear someone singing Marching to Zion, like, getting ready in the bathroom. So it was just a really cool experience to, when you know you're so delved into Adventist people and Christians and all this stuff, like, you just naturally get influenced by, like, good music. And that taught us a lot about how you can get influenced by negative other music too.
I want to second that thing. And when Anthony and I we were partners, so we would walk, we would take the elevator up together and go to the room together. And in the hallway, we would harmonize with each other, marching to Zion the whole way, and then getting ready for the next session. All the way marching back down. So yeah,
a bit of a theme song, I guess. Okay, so all five of you answered that question. Next one, three only. I'm just kidding. You can all talk as much as you want. So my next question is, was there anything that surprised you at the conference this year? If so, just share a little bit with us. So any surprises, anything that you didn't really expect would happen? Maybe for people whose first time it was going, maybe it was a surprise.
For me, what was really surprising is the amount of seminars there were. When I was going to GYC, I thought there would just be one sermon for everyone to attend. And one that really stood out for me was Never Good Enough. Mm-hmm. And it was really inspiring because the guy talked about how, like, we often compare ourselves with others, which isn't really healthy. And one verse that I really liked, I have it written down here, is Galatians chapter 1, verse 10, and it states, am I now trying to win the approval of men or of God? Or am I trying to please men? Mm-hmm. If I were still trying to please men, I would not be a servant of Christ.
Amen. Thanks, Susan.
And I really like that, and I mm-hmm. always think about it.
Cool. It was. I think the seminars were really cool, too. Anyone else? Any surprising moments?
I was surprised how many of us actually got up for breakfast.
because
it was, for me personally, like 6:30 is really early. I don't even get up for work at 6:30. So a lot of us, especially because we talked about it before and we're like, oh yeah, we're not, there's no way people are going. But yeah, I think most of us went to every breakfast. So,
yep. I almost didn't go to the last one, and then someone said, "You're not going to breakfast?" I'm like, ah, oh, fine, I'll go to breakfast. So I didn't miss any breakfast either. It was good.
The thing that surprised me the most was I was expecting all the girls to stay as a group the whole time and go to each session together. And the guy's like, "You know what, whatever, if I see you, I see you. If I don't, I don't. But I'm going to go over here, you can go over there." And it was really the other way around. All the guys stayed together and were like, "You know what, are you going to be there? Because I'm going to save you a seat. You better be there. And, you know, we're going to go." And then all the other, like the girls, they're like, "Oh, I'm going to go over there. And you go over there. And we're going over there. And we'll meet up later. And we're going to talk about each individual one." And I was like, "Wait, you guys went to different ones?" They're like, "Yeah, we don't need to go together, whatever." And I was like, "Oh, okay, that's cool. Totally not what I thought."
Yeah.
So that's what surprised me the most, the lack of holding each other's arms, like linking chains, like you usually do see girls do.
Yeah. No, that was really cool. Cool.
Yeah, guys need to do it more.
Cool.
I was really surprised by the speakers, because I guess going there, you don't know what to expect, but like listening to them and how they're like the simplest sermon was like the most touching one. And so I was like really surprised and blessed by that.
Yeah, very cool. I think we can all relate to that. Okay, next question. Was there any challenging moments of GYC? I think we already heard breakfast was a challenge, but we still made it.
Breakfast?
Any other challenges?
Food.
Food, okay.
Food in general.
Yeah.
Like,
but you didn't feel
bring
sick.
Bring snacks. You if you do go next
we did,
year,
we
bring
did.
Snacks.
We brought snacks. No.
I think the haystacks were the best.
Yeah,
a lot of snacks.
Yeah. It wasn't that bad, okay? We're just very, very privileged in our church. Any other challenging moments?
I have a challenging moment. So when we did the outreach, it was my first time going door to door. Actually, me and Susie and Bonnie went together. And we didn't know what to expect. And Susie and I were so nervous. Bonnie wouldn't really help us. She's just like, "You have to go. You have to do it." She's like, "I already did this."
I was trying to help you. That was me helping.
And so going door to door, like we were walking so slowly, and like when we knocked on the door, one house, I remember I zoned down. I was like, "Bonnie, I don't know what to say."
They would start talking, and then the person would be like, "Come in," and she'd be like, Bonnie, what do I do?" Because they told us not to go into the house. Bonnie, and I was like, "Okay, fine." I go up there and I walked in and I talked, and it was just it was just interesting because they were. I'm very nervous. But anyway, finish.
Anyways, yeah. But at the end, me and Susie were like, "Oh, we're going to go to those houses," even though it wasn't like on our street. And Bonnie was like, "Whoa, look at you guys." I think it was really challenging. And I realized that because I want to get into mission work, I realized that if I want to get into mission work, you have to start somewhere. But yeah, that was my experience.
And didn't you find that the more that we practiced and went to houses, it got so much easier? Like the first house versus the last house is a
big
difference.
Yeah, definitely.
To add on to our experience, there was one lady. It's when I tell the story, it's really funny now, but like we knocked on her door and that was like the second house or the third house, and I was really nervous. Mm-hmm. And she like comes and like the only thing that's visible is her eyes through the little window. And then I'm like, I introduced myself and I was talking about GYC, and she's like, "I don't mess with that." And she like slams the door and I was so scared. Mm-hmm. But it was so funny now that I think about it. Mm-hmm. But like that was like one of the challenging moments, but it was mm-hmm. really a blessing.
It can be very discouraging, right?
Yeah.
But as soon as you have that one person, that really encourages it, changes it.
Yeah, I guess being rejected by people,
mm-hmm.
you don't want to do it, right?
Mm-hmm.
But remember, I kept praying in my head. I was like, "Lord, you have to give us the strength to do this, because mm-hmm. there's someone out there who will be blessed by it."
That's true.
Then I want to, because they said their opinion about the outreach, I have to say my experience, because it was awesome.
Go ahead.
Now, it wasn't awesome because a lot of people want our pamphlets. Actually, no one on our street wanted our pamphlets. Zero people signed up for the thing when myself and my partner went. And now my partner, I'll reveal his identity in a second. So he's like, "So, Joel, are you going to introduce us or am I going to introduce us? Because it only says one person introduces us, and I don't know if I'm comfortable introducing us." And I'm like, "Okay, man, I'll introduce us. And then, you know, next house, you can." He's like, "Okay, that sounds good." So the first house, I introduce us. "Hi, my name is Joel. This is blank. You know, we're just here looking for blah, blah, blah." I said the whole spiel. And he's like, "Okay, next house,
I got it. I think I got this. So next house, we go up. Well, the next house, I answer the door. And the person opens the door, and he's like, hi, my name is, no, this is Joel, and we're here for 7 hours, and we're doing this, and you know, we were just wondering if you wanted to put your name on the phone, and the phone number, and the email. If you want the email, you don't have to do an email. We don't really need any of the emails, but we're just saying if you want it. So yeah, if you want to sign up, just circle. And I was like, yeah, so if you do, I'm holding in my lap. And it was David, and I couldn't. So I'm like, next house, I'm like, just slow down next time, man. And so next time he did, like the next houses, he got a lot better. But that first time, it killed me. It surprised me. I didn't know he would do that. So yeah.
I had a similar experience too. I just wanted to say, I was more like, me and my partner also didn't get any pamphlets filled out or anything, which was a little discouraging, but it was really cool to hear everyone else's experience as well. And I found that I was really encouraged that way, even though I had a very challenging outreach experience, but you guys encouraged me and made me laugh too, so. Okay, let's move on to the next question. I have two more left. Second last question is, did you learn something new about yourself or even in general after the conference?
I actually did, because I was very social with people and I'm usually not very quiet, and I met a lot of new people, and I think I was the only one that was like,
yeah, out Gina there was cranking. The most adventurous. She's just like, I met these people and these people. We're like, where's Gina? She's like, I made new friends. We're like, okay, cool.
Yeah.
That's awesome. That's great. Anyone else learn something new about yourself? No?
In the grander scheme of things, of learning something new about myself, I used to identify myself as a new-aged feminist, meaning that men and women should be equal in everything and that sort of thing. And I go to these sessions, and the sessions were called Being Male in the 21st Century and Biblical Correctness. And I realized I am not a feminist, actually, that I'm a Christian, and that defines my political view on that subject more than feminist defines my view on the subject. And I don't know if I'll talk about these sessions any more than right now, but the fact that Ephesians 5, chapter 5, verse 21, 22, and then 25, that defines my view on that topic in general. And I learned that just because I think a certain way doesn't mean the world has all the answers. It means the Bible has all the answers. Mm-hmm. And even in new questions that we're asking ourselves in today and age, like, people ask me in school, why do you read the Bible? It's so outdated. It was written 2,000 years ago. I'm like, well, it has all the answers ever that you'll ever need to know. So it's always relevant. And now, based in today's society, when equality and social issues are so prevalent, the Bible has all the answers for that. And I just figured out some of them. And yeah, cool. That's what I found something new about myself. I define myself a little differently now.
Very cool. Thanks. Does anyone else have anything to add? If not, I can move on to the next question. Okay. So the last question I want to ask is, was there anything you were inspired to change about your life after this weekend? So anything that you wanted to change about your life after this experience?
Okay, so I was actually inspired by the girls, because they were talking about how they deleted all their music and they're only listening to Christian music. And I know last Saturday we were going to the volleyball game, and you know, let's put on Christian music, and that's all we listen to. So I was just thinking about it today. I haven't turned on my radio since I got back because I don't want to, right? And then when I do put on music, it is Christian music or our music. But anyway, so they just they inspired me.
Very cool. Thanks. Anyone else? Any inspired changes? Well, we kind of heard Joel's already. His
changing. I literally forgot what to say, guys. I have nothing more. Well, my notes are done.
Your last comment was pretty.
Me neither. Well, I thought the last question was about outreach, so that's why I didn't talk for when you guys joined
I'll
in.
I'll ask about that outreach question.
Oh, okay. I'll wait.
Okay. Surprise, one more question. But anyone else want to talk about changes before we move on to outreach?
I have another one.
Go for it.
Okay. Just how important it is that we do what we say we're going to do. So we can talk all we want, and we have all of the right answers, and we know everything. But if people don't see that change in us, it's not going to make an impact. So sorry.
You took mine.
You didn't have anything to say.
It's like half of mine. The change that I, but the question is change in my life, right? I was really affected by that, how to be a male in the 21st century. I was so affected by it that now I'm kind of obsessed with going on YouTube and doing research on, what is the issues? And I started listening to Milo Yiannopoulos. There's some other feminist people I'm listening to as well, but predominantly Milo Yiannopoulos. And then I go to my workplace and I brought up the question, like, what do you guys think? And there's, you know, my workplace is really like, there's a lot of girls and guys and of different ages and cultures, and they don't seem whatever. So I found that I'm actually much more in tuned with debating in a intellectual level rather than just passion. I used to always be passion. That could override my lack of knowledge in the area. And Nathan knows all about it because that's what he complained about when we were having discussion. He's like, Joel, you don't know nothing but you're saying. You're just yelling louder than I am. And I'm like, well, that trumps everything you're saying. But now it's the other way around where I know more information than I did before. And I noticed that I'm more calm now, I think, because
Very
of that.
Cool. Go ahead. Yeah.
The change that I made was that I'm more open about, like, my religion, especially with my friends, because they're all, like, different religions, so I was kind of, like, scared to tell them, like, more about Jesus. Like, I was more, like, brief about it. They're like, oh, like, what do you do on Saturday? I go to church, I spend time with my youth, go to Vespers. But they didn't really, like, understand. They thought, like, going to church on Saturday was equivalent to going to church on Sunday. So, like, I told them, and they really, like, liked how passionate I was about GYC, and they saw, like, how, like, different I was. I was, like, happier, and I, like, was so passionate about, like, God. And
yeah, it kind of reminds, thank you. That kind of reminds me about, you know, going door to door too, because, like, at first you're really scared to talk to those people, and it's almost scarier to talk to your friends about that stuff. But I think we'd be surprised by how many people are really open to hearing what we have to say about that stuff.
I was really inspired to change and look at God in a different way, because you have all these, like, how do you say it? You look at God as if he's mean, or, like, why would this happen to you, right? And I know I hear it all the time, oh, God is love, but when I went to a Healing Broken Relationships seminar and actually went to all the sessions, and the main point I actually got from him was that God is love, and it made me look really and open my eyes and see how God really is love.
Amen, thanks. Okay.
One last thing, pretty much add on to that. The one, we went to, Joel and I, and Aaron and Samuel also went to the last session of that male in the 21st century, and it sort of went back to the God is love, and the way we have to live our lives is like Enoch. Yeah, Enoch. And he was always with God, but he wasn't just with God. He was just in the world and living a normal life, but living with God. And I always like thought, like, can you really live a normal life with God? Like, what is normal? And now I see, like, it's just, you have to be you with God. And that's what life should be.
Great. Thank you. So the last thing I'll ask now is if anyone wants to add I think it's really special to hear about outreach, because I think majority of us were like, this is going to be so scary and horrible. But does anyone want to just explain a little bit about their outreach experience? Actually, Anthony went on his own without the group, and we're like, where's Anthony? He's like, I found another group. I'm going to outreach. See you guys later. We're like, what? Anthony? So you want to tell us a little bit about your outreach?
Yeah. So pretty much what happened is I thought it through. I'm like, okay, this is my first time, but I've been to GYC, and I'm probably a little bit more like easygoing and like talkative than rest of the younger youth in our group. So I'm like, okay, Joel will have to go with someone in our youth. Nikki, Bonnie, Sasha will have to go with someone in our youth. So I just went on my own. And I'm like, I can figure it out. So I jumped on a random bus, and they're like, okay, everyone, who's younger than 18? So they had to put me with some random guy, and I was
with a chaperone. If you're under 18, they put you with someone older, yeah.
Yeah, so I was with some random black man, and it does matter in this story. It's not racist or anything. So we got on our way. We got off the bus. At first, we didn't know where we were because the street that we were on was not labeled. There was no label for that street. So eventually we found our way, and we started the first house. No one was there, and there's just these two women walking by, and they're like, one of them's like, "Hey, what y'all doing?" And we're like, "Oh, we're just spreading the word of Jesus," type thing, and she's like, "What is it, like Bible studies?" And we're like, "Yeah, can I sign up for that?" And it was just like, whoa, like automatic, like right off the bat, like first thing we got. And she wasn't even in our area. She was just walking through the area that we were supposed to do. And a couple, like, we got a lot of no's. But we only get like 9 surveys, because I think that's all GYC expects of us. And as long as we get that many, it's a big deal. And that's the truth. If we use all our surveys, it's a big deal, because everyone, almost everyone, said no. I don't need that, or I'm fine, thank you very much. And I'm like, or like a couple said, I'm not dressed, please just leave, like, because they're drunk from the night before. And one time, like one of the last houses that we went to, I introduced us and I listed off the things that we were offering, and she's like, "Oh yes, I want this, I want this, I want this," and then the guy that was with me offered to pray with them, as we're supposed to, and she's like, "Oh yes, yes, please, please, on the porch or inside," and he's like, "Whatever you feel like. Oh, just come on inside, come on inside." And her whole family's there, like her two kids are like in front of the TV, her husband's in the kitchen like helping with dinner, and they all stand up and we get in a circle and we start holding hands, and my partner starts praying. Mm-hmm. And like I was quite amazed by that, and I thought that was pretty cool. Yeah, that's really it.
Cool. Great. Thanks, Anthony. Does anyone else want to mention outreach? I think you all kind of mentioned already outreach, except...
I just need to add one more thing. Okay. Even though David made me laugh really hard, he also was the driving force in my positivity.
Great.
Because it doesn't matter that like each house that mm-hmm. we knocked on didn't really want the flyer or didn't want to take the survey. He's like, "You know what? No, let's just stop here and pray." I'm like, "You know what? You're the boss." And so we we stopped, we prayed, and then we kept walking, and... You know, even though the next house said no, he's like, "You know what, I really feel like the next one we're going to get it." Mm-hmm. You know, even though we didn't, he was positive the whole way through.
That's
really what made the experience enjoyable.
So it's important to encourage each other in this stuff.
And just last thing to add to that, the areas that we were sent to were not like privileged areas. They were not like, even the area that our church is in, that's not how it was. It was very like... The houses were like half demolished. rundown. A lot of them were boarded up and no one lived there at all. So we'd be like, okay, next house. And it's just, that's how it was. And that was normal in those areas. It was like...
Jane and Finch seemed upper scale.
Yes, that's quite accurate.
Go ahead. I just wanted to say, before we left, Mark Finley said that the angels had gone to the houses and prepared people's hearts. So I thought that was really amazing, because even though we got a lot of no's, I think we had some really good yeses. And I think those yeses trumped all the no's, yeah. Right? I just wanted to say that I was really proud of Gina and Susie, because they were very timid in the beginning. And I've done this before. It's not something that I also love to do, but I was like, you know what, like, I want them to do it. And I think they could do it. I knew that they could do it. So I was just proud how far they came. And that, you know, from the beginning, we're like, even walking, they couldn't even walk to the house. I was like trying to push them. Let's go, girls. They're like so slow. To the end where Gina was saying, like, let's do more. And I was like, wow, look at these girls go. So it was just really amazing to see that.
Yeah, I just wanted to add, because Susie and I talked about it after, we're like, no matter how much Bonnie, like, pushed us and she was, like, being mean, not that you're mean, but we were so thankful because we had...
I wasn't being mean. Forceful. Come on.
Yeah, forceful. We had such an amazing experience, and we actually got 6 or 7 people sign up for different things, so it was pretty cool.
Encouraging.
Yes, encouraging. Yes.
Amen. Lots of really great results. As we heard Sasha say, 5,000 people were prayed with, 1,300 had Bible studies, and it was just a really blessed experience. So.
And even if only one person, you know, yeah. comes to God, mm-hmm. God, you know, Jesus died for that one yeah. person. So.
Amen. Thank you, guys. That was awesome. Great experience. We're going to hear one more experience from David, and then that will wrap up our afternoon service.
I think Joel also forgot to mention humorous. I did my best, even though I did pray by the time we got to the second half of our street, but by the time we got to the end, I was slightly pessimistic, but I still think the experience overall was very good. Now, I think ever since this morning with Vanessa and Emily, they mentioned since this morning about the sessions, and then Sasha mentioned that there were about 17 overall, and right now tonight, I'm gonna kind of delve deeper into maybe what one of those 17 sessions were. And so to start off, the sessions has very varying topics, but for me, when I saw this title for this session, I attended 5 out of the 6. The other one I attended was Being a Male in the 21st Century. But when I saw this one, this is one of the ones listed, I knew that I think it was important for me to go. Not because I struggled with what they were talking about, I definitely don't, but in today's world, I think is extremely relevant. And so the session I attended was titled Unraveling the Gay Spin, which also kind of talked about people in the LGBT group. And if you don't know, that key term stands for lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender. Thank you. And so there were 4 speakers overall. And it was 3 men and 1 woman. Each of them once dealt with same-sex attraction. And each of them had their own special, like, testimonials. One of them was actually a prostitute at one point. And another one, this one was even more tragic. He had a terrible childhood. His mother had so strongly wanted a girl that she savagely abused him, and she broke both his arms before he was even 2 years old. Yeah. And if it was not for the help of his Seventh-day Adventist aunt and uncle, who actually took him in at when he was younger and patiently taught him God's love, it wouldn't be until later in his life that if it weren't for them, he doesn't think he would have been able to find God and be able to turn his life around. Now, like I said before, the messages they gave, especially to somebody like me, I want to personally kind of go into a teaching field, which means I have to meet with a lot of people. And I need to learn also how to understand people. So I personally found these sessions invaluable. So I'll begin with the with the phrase that I'm pretty sure everybody in this room knows, that according to the Bible, God does not approve homosexuality. It's very clear. He mentions it in the Old and New Testament, just so people are not confused. And it's not even in the slightest what God has originally planned for us. But kind of in that category, especially when Christians have to meet with these people, there's kind of a myth that still tends to live on in kind of our society or social groups, and not just Christians, but maybe with other people. And we debunked this theory of permanent homosexuality, that once you are gay, you're gay for life, and that you can't do anything else about this. And one thing that was huge for me, maybe is one of my biggest experiences, was that I learned about a Bible verse that is the main foundation of how we debunked this theory. It's found in 1 Corinthians. Might want to flip to this. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, 9 to 11. It's in the New King James Version. I'll read. Do you not know that the unrighteous will inherit the kingdom of God? So once again, God's being clear, or Paul in this case. Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. So it's very clear. But the clincher comes in verse 11. And such were some of you. But you were washed, but you were sanctified, but you were justified in the name of Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. So this verse on its own completely annihilates that concept. But to kind of add on to that a little bit more, by saying that they should remain in their current state or that they can't be changed, we're basically saying that Jesus isn't strong enough to save them. And knowing that we're trying to proclaim the greatness of our God, I think that's very counter, it's kind of hypocritical of us to kind of say something like that. Now, another topic that I'm pretty sure all of us have heard about, if on the news. Now, one big problem that we face is how to deal with the defined gender of those who call themselves transgender. It's a very, very, it's a topic you kind of, maybe you want to skirt around, or one that you think is a bit too hard to tackle. Now, in our secular world, calling somebody like Bruce Jenner, who is a man, just that, a man, you will find yourself being called a bigot and a hater. But we know that God is clear. You cannot mutilate the body and just expect the rest of it to react the same way. Your DNA stays the same, and your mind is hardwired to be what God meant you to be. And because of this, because of sin, Satan blurs the lines of gender because we allow our feelings to define us, which is definitely not in God's blueprint. That was one of the points that was mentioned early on. Another touchy subject that they tackled was the process of converting people who live this kind of lifestyle. Now, when going to these people who have made their decision to sin, that, of course, is their own decision. But even so, our duty to them is not to focus purely on changing that sin above all else. And we're even talking about how they're supposed to start, how, and then after that, we're supposed to start on how they're beginning to know, how they're supposed to know God. Sorry about that. The fact is, we're focusing purely on that sin, and we're kind of putting the love for God kind of second, because we believe that sin is the hugest thing we have to change. That is not the right way to go about it. And to counter that, here's an example. Now, kind of one thing that I think is huge is that when the Bible says and talks about being born again, is it talking about your attraction? Being born again, as we know, means dying and giving up what kept you bound to this world. So by knowing God, you're already supposed to know by His commands that you're not supposed to continue doing what you're doing. And you're supposed to give it all to Jesus. But of course, this is only assuming that these people have met His presence and wish to know Him. The verse that confirms this is 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation.
all things have passed away. Behold, all things have become anew. It's a part of the process. It's not the first thing you have to do. You have to give up to God when you see that you're in need. And if that's not the case, then that's just how it is. It's your choice. God loves you so much that no matter that he's going to let you do what you want to do, no matter how much it tears him up inside. But he's always willing to love you as his own. These people in the LGBT community are just that. People. We are not meant for this world. And all of us get so closely wrapped in it that we don't recognize that we were meant for more than its suffering and confusion of purpose. It's our duty to be servants of God and a friend to all men and women. Now to finish off, speak on the topic of stewardship, one of the speakers there, the one woman I mentioned earlier, Danielle Harrison, her session was called Sharing the Cross Connection. And this, I think, was a very key session because it deals directly with how do we outreach to these kind of people. It's a very big topic. And she stated plainly, many of them have suffered from rejection and neglect and some kind of abuse. They need something to fulfill their purpose in their lives. They need forgiveness and love. And you see it so much nowadays. She stated that 40% of homeless youth are LGBT. They're highly rejected by their families, and they're 8 times more likely to commit suicide. And they even have more reports of substance abuse. But we know in the Bible that God changed Saul into Paul. And so the solution is Christ's method, which she stated was in the Ministry of Healing, page 143.3, also in the Desire of Ages. Now, the first step that she mentioned was to mingle with them. You have to make sure that at that point that they believe in their lives right now that they're trying to do the best they can, that they're trying to do the thing what's right. Now, don't compromise Christ. Show who you are in Christ. And when you meet them, you have to step forward, not back. Make eye contact and smile. Be genuine and not fake. And when you do meet with them, try to find common ground. Ask who they are and what they like to do. And then, in the next step, you have to be the one who desires their well-being. Show them that you care and you want the best. Remember how they are like this. Have Christ's heart. Have compassion, not judgment. The next step that she showed us was to show sympathy. Invest time and energy in this friendship. Listen to them, which means you don't always have to talk, and have your full attention. Teach them by our actions that they have infinite value in God. And of course, prayer, intercessory. It has to be consistent, it has to be intentional, and when you talk about them and maybe what they're dealing with, you have to be specific. And you also, sometimes, if they come to you, you gotta try and have answers for tough questions. You won't always, but since you're there, you're not God's emissary to them, but you're trying to do your best to show them who God is. And invite God to use you to that they can see and accept who Jesus is. And of course, like I said, you have to prepare yourself to answer questions. The next step was gaining trust. Use nature to communicate God's concepts, how he is, how he designed the world. And use their past words to kind of get points across. So don't just be plain and unspecific. You gotta tell them maybe they had some type of boyfriend or girlfriend in the past, and you gotta try and make a point across. You also have to be patient. And also, even when you're talking with them, Danielle specifically mentioned not to be afraid to admit your own faults or mistakes. Maybe you miscommunicated something to them and it left a bad thought in their mind. And so now you go to them and you fully admit that you made a mistake and that you're willing to correct it. And they see this and they won't think that you're all high and mighty. And of course, they'll think of you as humble because you don't see yourself as perfect. So apologize whenever necessary. And of course, the next step, showing Jesus. When we are with these people, we have to let them initiate spiritual conversation. They'll see our lives, and so they'll ask us thought-provoking questions, We have to convey God's love, and we also, if they do bring it up, we have to make sure that they know what they've done is in the past, and that God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit are still there for him. We have to show God's nature and character, which is best shown with the woman at the well with Jesus. And she gave a whole bunch of other Bible texts as well. We have to validate God's word by showing them its effect on your life. You have to show that what we do affects our spirituality and encourage them as well to pray. And the final point that she made was that God's blessings are conditional, but his love is never extinguished. And that was the final point that she brought to me. And that was what I learned from GYC. Thank you.
Thank you, David. So now we're just going to collect our offering before we finish. So if Joshua, if you can come up and read a verse for us. Thanks.
Hello. So for the offering verse, I will be reading Psalm 31, verse 24. If I can just find it right here. Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart, all of you who hope in the Lord. May I please call the deacons up? Please stand up just please bow your heads for prayer. Dear Lord, hallowed be your name, and thank you for everything that you have done for us in our lives. And thank you for everyone that has been able to come here safely so that they may have learned all the things that these 15 or so youth have learned at GYC. And please let all the offering that the deacons have collected to be used for what you think is right, and that it may help the cause of whoever needs help in their lives. In your name, amen.
So thank you to everyone who shared their experience and their testimonies. And I just wanted to say that it wasn't just a one-person organized thing. I had help from so many people, and everyone was just so encouraging. And whenever I said, like, let's go to this, people were like, okay, let's go. It was really, really encouraging, and we all encouraged each other, and it was a really fun experience. If anyone wants to hear any of the seminars, there were 17 different six-part seminars on audioverse.com is where you can listen to them. So at the end, we would like to sing one last song, 183, Gledam u Hrista. So song 183.
Gledam u Hrista bez presta, kaj ja s njim. Please bow your heads for prayer. Dear Lord, thank you for such wonderful youth in this church and giving them an opportunity to go to a seminars like these and being blessed as they were. Please let more of these trips happen in the future, and please give us the opportunity to bring more people to them as well. Bless the Holy Spirit upon us, and let us bring this light that we got from these seminars to the world and to the week to come. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen.
Thank you, everyone, for coming to our afternoon service. Hope you're a little bit inspired. I know I was, and I was there, which is so extra bonus. But I hope you all have a blessed week, and see you in this place next week.